Shalom, Tina is telling. Shalom, Rastafari. Actually, we're gonna go forward with what we've been speaking of. Verse 1, Psalm 72, concerning Solomon, a description of the kingdom. You know, give the king thy judgments, O God, and the righteousness, thy righteousness to the king's son, and how these are descriptions of the two advents in one view, as we have been discussing. That is also contained in the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 7 and chapter 9. Chapter 7 being a description of God the Son, Jesus, and the Christ, and then the description of chapter 9 would be made manifest through Lich Tafari, His Majesty Most High Jah, you know, Haile Selassie I. And we also went forward to briefly to chapter 11, which is chapter 11 verse 1, which is a description of both the son, the king, and the king's son within that same verse, and which is and there shall spring forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch out of the root. And like we made mention, we failed twice to be able to explain that, like, verbally, so we insist and make known to all that we're going to bring forth that particular verse and explain it visually. So, yeah, going forward. Now, we're in the book of the prophet Isaiah, chapter 61, and how Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christos, only fulfilled up into the comma of chapter 61, verse 2, and how His Majesty fulfills the remaining part of that sentence, and you know, clearly and perfectly, rightly, correctly aligning itself to what we've mentioned concerning Psalm 72, verse 1, which reads, "To whom pertaineth our judgments? To whom is given the vengeance? To God the Father, Christ in His kingly character, and to whom is attributed ascribed righteousness? To the king's son, you know, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord." You know, these things cannot be any more clear. But we're gonna go ahead and make them more clear, you know, because there's abundant evidence concerning this. So now we'll go forward to Proverbs, to the book of Proverbs. And this is the book of Proverbs, chapter 30. One second. And so, but actually, being that we're already within the prophets, we'll bring forth these words of wisdom. And it's chapter 25, Warnings and Instructions Continued. These are also proverbs of Solomon, which the men of Hezekiah, king of Judah, copied out. It is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a matter. So let us go on forth and search out this matter. Kebra Negesh, the glory and the honor of kings, you know, the glory of God to conceal a thing and the honor of kings to seek out that matter. To search it out, to diligently, you know, improve I myself, show I myself approved to the Almighty God, being able to rightly divide His word, you know, truly and rightly. So going forward, chapter 30, the words of Agur, the words of Agur, the son of Jake, even the prophecy. Okay, this, we're not too quite sure on this, but Jake, it kind of makes us think that it's. We're gonna go forward really quickly to the Book of Chronicles, because it sounds like someone within the family of the Kenites, which are descendants of Jethro, Hobab, and that family, which are from which family comes Rahab. And so I'll make mention of Babylon and and Rahab to them that know me, and all that. And okay, we'll bring forth some. Well, we're trying to make time, so all right. Well, we won't go forward with that, cause it is important, but it's concerning what we're bringing forth. It doesn't really bring all that much. It doesn't make much difference, you know, concerning what we're particularly addressing within this reasoning. So we'll just go forward and just bring forth this, you know, what we had in mind. But even the prophecy, the man spake to Ithiel, even to Ithiel and Ukal. Okay. We'll just make mention. Yeah, we can't seem to just forget about this. Jethro is a very, very interesting character. So many titles. The man. The priest of Midian. Jethro. Yithro. In the Hebrew, at times it is spelled Yithro and Yithro. Yithro containing four letters, and Yithro, three. So that is interesting. Reguel. So there's a progression concerning this man, this stranger, whom brought forth the first the blessing upon the Almighty, you know, in all the scripture. But in the book of First Chronicles, and this is the posterity of Jesse, and we have, goes into his sisters, and Abigail bear Amasa. David the seventh, whose sisters were Zeruiah and Abigail, the sons of Zeruiah, Abishai and Joab, Asahel, three. And Abigail bare Amasa. And the father of Amasa was Jether, the Ishmaelite. So, who bare Amasa? Abigail, sister of David, posterity of Jesse. And the father of Amasa was Jethro, the Ishmaelite. So, you know, it just becomes very clear, the house of David upon Ethiopia, you know. So we just had to bring that forth, but that had nothing to do with the reasoning. So actually, we'll go forward to it. We'll continue on with the reasoning. So Proverbs, and we'll just go forth to verse 4, which is our main focus. And it reads, "Who hath ascended up into heaven, or descended? Who hath gathered the wings in his fists?" Question mark. "Who hath bound the waters in a garment? Who hath established all the ends of the earth? What is his name? And what is his son's name? If thou canst tell." So, once again, we have these prophetical words and referring to what is his son's name, the king, to whom judgment and vengeance is attributed to or allotted to. And what is his son's name? So, you know, clear. This is also very clear. We'll bring forth more evidence. And it'll come in the form of, we'll go really quickly to the book of Exodus. Not too sure why. This won't be too clear, but still it's it'll come to it. So book of Exodus chapter 23 verse 20. "Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in thy way, and to bring thee into the place which I have prepared. Beware of him, and obey his voice. Provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgression, for my name is in him." So, an angel. messenger, a king's messenger, will go forward and say, you know? But, more evidence, clear evidence, irrefutable, undisputable truth, the book of Deuteronomy. See, what we're trying to show here is that it's not only within the prophet Isaiah that these truths are found. And the world has to wake up, and religion's gotta, you know, either decide, you know, they serve Satan, or they get with the truth, which is what we here declare. See, the thing is, it's sad, you know, we've witnessed and we testified to elder ladies, you know, with this look of vain hope, in the sense that, and this question, and even, we've heard testimonies as these from a few different people. When do you think that he's gonna come? Stuff to that effect, and that it's really sad, because if we were taught and learnt in the scriptures and how clear it is concerning the advents and the manifestations and their rightful responsibilities and the character which would be manifested at each individual time, if we were learnt of this, then the world would have no difficulties accepting His Majesty to be he that he be, and this world would have already moved on into this kingdom age, you know, this new age, this new day brought to us, you know, through the King of Kings, you know, His Majesty, Abba by John Hoy, our Father Majesty, and so who declared the Son, in whom His name is, you know, and the Son keeping I and I as Rastafari in the Father's name. So all these things would have been clear. People are expecting Christ, yeses, this, you know, to be made manifest as He was in times 2,000 years ago. The thing is, first of all, one thing is, which one of the many different fake images of the whitewashed Christ are you expecting? Every church has like abundant different white Christ within their own church. They, you know, they can't make up their mind which one of these thousands and thousands of fake and not true slander and devilish and lying images are. So first of all, you have that dilemma. Which one of the millions of white imposter Christ is it going to be? Every church has like different kinds of, I mean, any white guy with blue eyes, blonde hair, and straight hair is represented as Christ. So which one of all those, right? Now, another thing is that once you accept the truth that Christ is a black man, an Ethiopian man, now we have another dilemma. he is not to come in the same manifestation form. There are certain scriptures that must be fulfilled. You know, heaven and earth shall pass. No, excuse me. Yeah, heaven and earth shall pass, but not one jot or one tittle of the law shall pass without being fully filled. So there are certain responsibilities, and as we have explained and shown clearly, certain responsibilities are attributed and given to the Son in His power, which is righteousness, all things, all righteousness given to the Son, Jesus Christos. And then we have another role and responsibility, Christ in His kingly character, His Imperial Majesty, Most High God, Jah Rastafari, you know, Selassie, elect of God, King of Kings of Ethiopia, conquering land of the tribe of Judah, and Him being the King to whom is allotted vengeance and judgment, and to the King's Son, righteousness, over and over. So what we're trying to bring forth here is that this is this plain and obvious truth, and the reason the world has failed to accept it is to glorify Rastafari. It's the only reason. It's not that the world is not intellectually, you know, capable of comprehending this, but the Almighty God, you know, wanting to glorify one people upon this earth, and that be Rastafari, Israel, in spirit and in truth, so that all people would know. So going forward, we know and we do testify that people, so that people can thus, you know, begin to accept that which is, or you know, take your side alongside Satan. And so that devil, you know, that serpent, liar, slander since the beginning. Actually, say, in Spanish, the word, there's a certain word, we kind of forgot what word it even is, but it has to do with, the deceiver, the definition, we give thanks to Almighty God, you know, Rastafari. And so, the word deceiver in Spanish is imposter. And so yeah, so that imposter since the beginning, it's a lot more clear than deceiver, because you know, because we're not too well learned in English as we are made to pretend that we are. So yeah, going forward, now all throughout scripture. So now we've gone and explained this and justified it, our claims clearly within the book of the prophet Isaiah. We've gone to the book of Luke, we've gone to Psalms, we've gone to Proverbs, we've just came from Exodus, now we're in the book of Deuteronomy, and it's Deuteronomy chapter 17. So, this is no avoiding it, it is what it is. Book of Deuteronomy chapter 17. So not one, well actually, just to clarify this, let's go forward to the book of St. Matthew, because it's going to be chapter 5, verse, and this is all within Rastafari Sendet Shabbat study Torah portions, or written about number 17, Yethro, Jethro, the father of the Ethiopian wife of Moses, Zipporah. You know, I mean, how it can't be any more clear, really. But yes, it can, and we'll all make it more clear. So going forward, relation of Christ to the law, and the book of St. Matthew, Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 5, verse 18. For verily I say to you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or tittle shall in no wise pass from the law, till all be fulfilled. So all got to be fulfilled, right? And so, not all was fulfilled by Jesus, the Christ, the Son of God. But, you know, those things pertaining to the power of the mighty Trinity, the, you know, God, the Father, you know, fulfilled in and through our Majesty, our Baba Jan Hoy. So now, Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 14, concerning a king, you know, is the Majesty. To whom vengeance and judgment is allotted to. When thou art come to the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, and shall possess it, and shall dwell therein, and shall say, I will set a king over me, alike as all the nations that are about me. Thou shalt in any wise set him king over thee, whom the Lord thy God shall choose, elect of God. So you make Zabir, one from among thy brethren shalt thou set king over thee. Thou mayest not set a stranger over thee, which is not thy brother, but he shall not multiply horses to himself, or nor cause the people to return to Egypt to the end that he should multiply horses, for as much as the Lord hath said to you, ye shall henceforth return no more that way. So now, we weren't even supposed to read that whole thing, right? And verse 18, and it shall be, when he sitteth upon the throne of his kingdom, that he shall write him a copy of this law in a book of that which is before the priest of the Levites. That book, the book of the seven seals, the Metahaf Kedus, you know, the Royal Amharic Rastafari Bible, you know, which a fulfillment, this was not fulfilled by Christ Jesus. This is fulfilled in his majesty, Christ in his kingly character. And another thing, chapter 18 goes into the tribe of Levi. So the book of the Levites, not the book of the Levites, but this law in a book out of that which is before the priest of the Levite. We have to accept that the sons of Moses with Zipporah the Ethiopian, Gershom and Eleazar, those sons are to be counted with the Levites. So, yes, it is very much clear and very true. Some Levites are Ethiopian. It don't matter what people want to make to believe or pretend or how. You know, it don't matter. Because if it's either the Book of Kings or the Book of Chronicles clearly declares that. That the sons of Moses are to be allotted the that which is to be allotted to the Levites. So, and even it's funny, we've always contemplated the fact that Aaron had a son named Eleazar and Gershon. Moses' sons are Gershon and Eleazar. I mean, they're pretty much one and the same. They have like one letter which is a difference. Now, we try to look for something within that, and it is given to us the information as to who bear Aaron those sons. So it kind of canceled out our thought that maybe Gershom and Eleazar, which are sons of Aaron, were kind of like given the responsibility of or get handed over to Aaron. Well, actually, that wouldn't have been possible because Aaron took off. Okay, we're getting into something that we weren't supposed to get into, but we thought that maybe those two sons of Moses somehow were attributed to Aaron because of the law, you know, kind of. But you know, that's kind of like off topic. So going forward, still within the Book of Deuteronomy. So now we have the prophecy of a king, you know. And within the Book of Deuteronomy, we have chapter 18, verse 15. And it reads, and the title is The Great Prophecy of Mashiach, the Prophet. The Lord thy God will raise up to thee a prophet from the midst of thee, of thy brethren, like to me. To him ye shall hearken, according to all that thou desirest of the Lord thy God in Horeb in the day of the assembly, saying, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, neither let me see the great fire any more, that I die not. Who cometh with fire? Judgment, the king. Who is the Mashiach? The king's son. You know, he comes in grace and in mercy and to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. That is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christos. You know, His Majesty came with judgment, with fire, you know, the burning of fuel and fire, with judgment, you know, to judge the earth for the wrongdoing, you know. This is all very so too easy, almost, but yet so hard for the world to this deceived world to comprehend. So now, so even that explains to us right there, clean, very clear, a question we actually had ourselves in the mount. Who was speaking in the mount when the peoples did not want to hear that voice no more? Well, it was His Imperial Majesty, whom said, "This is Jesus, listen to Him, in whom we are well. I am well pleased." So that's a whole different study, but very interesting in itself. So now going forward, I will raise them up a prophet from among the brethren. Okay, verse 19. And it shall come to pass that whosoever will not hearken to my words, which he shall speak in my name, I will require it of him. So now, even the test of the prophets, which is verse 20 of the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 18, it goes into how to like kind of discern between a true prophet and a false prophet. And so, the true prophet, his words come to pass, and the words of Jesus came to pass, come to pass, will always come to pass, and the word of His Majesty came to pass, has, will come to pass, and has come to pass, will come to pass, and so on and so forth. Okay, going forth, and you know, 1936, Geneva, Switzerland, judging the world, you know. Well, the world judged themselves by the actions, you know. And they have to take responsibility. We have to take responsibility for our decision, and that was to abandon His Majesty, you know, break covenant, and thus World War II, you know. Nonetheless, what we're trying to say is that this gives us an indication as to how to separate a false prophet from a true prophet. And a true prophet that comes in the power of God Almighty is a prophet that speaketh that which comes to pass. And truly, we here do testify, Rastafari, that Iyesus Kristos and Haile Selassie first both fulfill these requirements. So now going forward, and okay, one extra note concerning this. In the book of Exodus, Moses was to be as a god to Pharaoh, and Aaron was to be his prophet. Aaron is the high priest. Iyesus Kristos is the high priest. God is to be the Father glorified in Iyesus Kristos. God, Haile Selassie first, the manifestation of God the Father, Christ in His kingly character, His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie first, elect of God, conquering line of the tribe of Judah, King of Kings of Ethiopia. So, how clear can it be? Well, He cometh with clouds. You know, we made mention in a reasoning concerning the kingdom, and it's within Rastafari Shabbat Senbet study number 17, Yitro, Jethro, how the kingdom was twofold, very visible but very invisible, and very real but still very surreal. And so the reason we make mention of this is because we keep on saying how more clear can this be. So to some, it is very clear, but to others, it is not clear at all, because to some, He cometh with clouds, with confusion, with kind of like not clearness, but to others, he comes clearly. You know, the Lamb, one comes and openeth not His mouth, Iyesus Kristos, but still on the sermon, within the Sermon on the Mount, He opened His mouth and taught His disciples, those that were willing and desired Him with all their strength, might, and soul. And so this too applies. This is so we'll go forward. Now